Hey man, just wanted to reach out, let you know that I'm thinking of you. I know life has been pretty tough lately, so I just wanted to let you know that I'm here for you if you want to chat, anything you need. Lunch, dinner, coffee, just let me know.
That friend who, whenever they walk in the room, seems to bring an irrepressible energy and joy. They're the definition of the life of the party, and it seems like everywhere they go, they're a bright spot in the world.
Do you ever wish you could be like them? But every time it gets quiet, you feel a sadness, a desperation, a loneliness. It feels like every time you want to be able to put on joy and energy and excitement, your mind rebels against you.
Selena Gomez has been pretty open about her mental health and, in her words, her problems with depression and anxiety. She's a successful businesswoman, producer and actor, musician, fashion icon, cook, you name it. She's even, as of this recording, the most popular person on Instagram with 400 million followers. But yet, she struggles with her mental health, a battle she thinks she'll fight for the rest of her life.
Instead of hiding her mental health struggles, Selena decided to speak up and share her story, and she continues to do so. Her goal is to remove some of the stigma around mental disorders and help people understand that they're not alone. It's almost as if she's saying that even at the top of the world, living a life that she would call extremely blessed, we can still wrestle with our mental health.
Just like before, we want to begin our discussion by pausing and answering a question. Take some time with the people around you and talk about this question. When do you feel the happiest?
Maybe you noticed a pattern in your answers. Maybe you feel happiest when you feel safe and secure. Maybe it's related to the people you're with, your friends and your family. Maybe you feel happiest when you feel connected to the world around you, or maybe it's when you feel connected with Jesus.
Or maybe for some of you, you realize you haven't felt happy in a long time. In our first episode, we talked about anxiety and anxiety disorders, but now we're going to shift our focus to another mental disorder, depression.
Again, we hope this video series is a helpful resource for understanding and discussing mental health. It is not meant to be a tool for diagnosing depression, anxiety, or any other mental disorders. If, as you watch this video, you continually identify and relate with many of the symptoms, we highly encourage you to talk to a medical professional who will be able to help you identify where you're at and what some of your next steps are.
But as we begin our discussion on depression, we want to make sure we're all talking about the same thing. There are two big types of depression, bipolar depression and major depression.
The phrase major depression is used to distinguish one form of depression from the other, also sometimes called unipolar depression, just because it doesn't have the highs and lows, the other one being bipolar depression. Bipolar depression, sometimes called bipolar disorder, is really characterized by manic highs, so where people aren't sleeping and they're talking very fast and they're buying things and pursuing resources that they can't afford. They're starting relationships left and right. They're manic. followed by periods of crashes, of feeling very low, lethargic, and so on.
While bipolar depression is incredibly significant and important, we're going to focus our discussion on major depression, which is often what people are referring to when they use the term depression.
But not all of the time. In our modern world, we often equate depression with a general sense of sadness. When we're feeling dramatic, we might say the season finale of a show was depressing, or we might say we're feeling depressed after our team lost because of a bad call from a ref.
Those are pretty light examples, but it's worth saying. Sometimes the world we live in will bring us sadness. Whether it's the sudden death in the family, the loss of a job or a friend group, or something as simple as the ending of a romantic relationship.
Why don't you just buy the whole song?
I don't have to buy it. I just want to taste it. I just want a little taste of it.
Oh, look at this. She saved you $2,000 because they failed to report a mold problem. But wouldn't that affect the final... How did she... Oh, I see what she did. That is good. Wow. That Carol is one smart cookie.
Goodbye, my lover. Goodbye, my friend.
So it's very natural and healthy to have periods of sorrow, yet these moments tend to dissipate. And this is one of the major differences between feeling sad and clinical depression.
Clinical depression is different. It's a medical disorder, and it won't go away just because you want it to. It lingers for at least 2 consecutive weeks and significantly interferes with one's ability to work, play, or love. Depression can have a lot of different symptoms: a low mood, loss of interest in things you'd normally enjoy, changes in appetite, feeling worthless or excessively guilty, sleeping either too much or too little, poor concentration, restlessness or slowness, loss of energy, or recurrent thoughts of suicide.
So depression is a low period that sticks with us for a substantial amount of time. We'll talk a little more about some of those symptoms in a second. But first, we want to focus on a period of sadness and low energy that can last for weeks on end.
Having depression does not mean we're sad all the time. But it does mean we can get stuck in a period of sadness or numbness. And this can have a cause, a triggering event, but sometimes there's no apparent cause. Nothing has obviously happened to make us feel low, but we do. And it's affecting our ability to get out of bed in the morning, to brush our teeth, and to do the basic things that we should do.
People are always telling me about great TV shows, how I just have to watch this show. But the truth is, I don't want good TV. I don't want a novel or some slow burn or anything that feels like work. That's why I love reality TV. It's funny, it's dramatic, and I can focus on it. It's pure, effortless entertainment. I want to lay down one moment and then look around the next and realize I have watched 22 straight hours of Love Island over a 2-day period and yearn for more. Some people may find that depressing. I don't. It is, however, a good way to measure depression. Because when reality TV begins to feel like work, like final season of Mad Men work, you know you're depressed. Like, haven't got out of bed to pee in 24 hours, depressed.
Let's pause and unpack that scene from Euphoria. First, the main character, Rue, has diagnosed bipolar depression. Remember the one we weren't talking about? The lows of bipolar depression can often look similar to the lows of major depression, so it can be helpful to see as we talk about major depression. Second, Rue, in this fictional scene, has neglected to take her prescribed medication, so the effects are hitting hard.
Third, Euphoria isn't a show we would necessarily recommend, but it does show depression in a realistic light. Depression isn't a glamorous thing. It looks like not being able to eat or overeating, not being able to sleep but staying in bed for days at a time, forgetting to take care of our hygiene, having trouble connecting with our friends and loved ones, even struggling to find joy in the things we used to love.
Andy, are you okay?
Oh, I'm fine. It's just that life is pointless and nothing matters and I'm always tired. Also, I can't sleep. I'm overeating. None of my old hobbies interest me.
Ever since Andy failed the police academy exam, his self-esteem has hit rock bottom. He's always sad and sweaty. He's usually happy and sweaty.
Let's pause for a second and answer a question. When you're feeling sad or maybe even depressed, what do you do that helps? Share your strategies with the people around you.
I have bipolar disorder and major depressive disorder. A few years ago, I spent months in a depressive episode. I barely ate, never changed my clothes, and I would sleep for 12 to 13 hours at a time, but I was never less tired. Worse than any of that, though, was the sense of total numbness I felt. I knew the people around me loved me and were worried about me, but I just didn't have the energy to care. It felt like the part of me that knew how to be happy was completely gone. I've walked through a lot of mental health challenges, but depression has been one of the most painful. When you're suffering from severe depression, you barely feel human.
So sometimes depression is outside of our control, like Selena Gomez singing about her mind rebelling against her. It's not a character flaw, and it's not something we can simply will ourselves to overcome.
Take, for example, feeling tired and having trouble sleeping. For many people with major depression, they often wake up early, at say, 3 a.m., still feeling exhausted but unable to go back to sleep. This is because in the brain of someone with major depression, the cycles needed for high quality sleep are being disrupted. Even if they fall asleep, their sleep just isn't as effective.
This isn't really something you can control or can fake for that matter. You're unconscious, but your brain's natural cycles are off. It's worth stating that sleep is maybe the most important thing when it comes to our health in general. So when our sleep is disrupted, a lot of other things will follow.
Now, something like a lack of appetite feels like it's more under our control. We can just force ourselves to eat, right? But it's actually similar to being unable to get high quality sleep. Our brains and bodies have systems to tell us when we're hungry, when we're thirsty, and when we need to do things like use the bathroom. And major depression can disrupt and disorder these systems. This is why depression falls under the category of mental disorder.
And remember, these sorts of symptoms are often conjoined with feelings of deep sadness and despair, a lack of energy, and often, and we'll get to this idea in our next episode, guilt and low self-esteem.
So what can we do with depression? Well, first, it's important to note that an episode of major depression disorder doesn't begin overnight. It can often be a slow build, and it's not always consistent.
Symptoms, duration, and intensity of depressive episodes can be different from person to person, and this is why it's important to speak to a qualified medical professional if we think we have depression or are sliding into a depressive episode.
On top of this, there are ways to treat the symptoms of depression. We can do simple things like getting exercise, improving our diets, and pursuing spiritual health and life-affirming relationships. These can also be helpful to slow the slide into a depressive episode.
There's also therapy and possibly medication. Often, it's going to be some combination of different things. Part of the medical professional's job is to get to know us and help us identify what will be most helpful for us.
In my experience, medication made a huge difference in rebalancing the chemicals in my brain. But the biggest thing that keeps me from sinking into that place again is having people around me who know how I behave when I'm depressed and can get me the help I need even when I'm unable to ask.
Before we finish our conversation on depression, just like with anxiety, we want to talk about the spiritual side of things. Yes, depression is a physical and mental thing that can occur in us, but we're not just physiological and psychological creatures. When God created us, He intricately designed us, but part of that design is spiritual. To fully understand depression, we can't ignore the mental and physical sides, but you also can't ignore the spiritual side.
Sometimes in the Christian world, we can call depression a choice. We can give people damaging advice, saying they should just snap out of it or pray themselves out of their depressive hole. The least helpful thing might just be the idea that depression is the result of a lack of faith. And if we prayed harder or loved the Lord more, we wouldn't struggle with it.
We want to be very clear. This is a lie. We don't want to discount the power of prayer when we talk about mental disorders, but there's no truth in the idea that depression is somehow a spiritual failing.
This is probably most clear in the Bible. The Bible is full of people wrestling with sadness and what looks an awful lot like depression. The Psalms, many of which David wrote, are full of lamentations, essentially really sad poems that wrestle with the fact that God is good, while admitting that sometimes it cannot seem that way.
There's Jeremiah, who is often called the weeping prophet, who wrote a book literally called Lamentations and spent most of his life getting beat up for saying what God told him to. Lamentations 3 starts with, "I am the man who has seen affliction under the rod of his wrath. He has driven and brought me into darkness without any light."
It probably wouldn't be right to tell David or Jeremiah, "Hey man, maybe if you had more faith, you wouldn't feel so bad." But we can learn from their response to their emotional state. They took their despair, sadness, and possibly their depression to the Lord. And we can do the same. Part of battling depression is believing that God cares about that depression, because He does. God wants us to bring our troubles to Him.
When it comes to depression, there's a very real chance we'll need help to get our brains and our bodies into proper order again. We might need therapy or possibly medication. We'll need friends who love us well and care about us. But we also can't discount the role of the spiritual in our recovery.
We'll leave you with an encouraging promise from Jesus Himself. "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light."
We hope you enjoyed this Conversation Kit episode. At Access, we're passionate about creating resources that help connect parents and caring adults with the teens in their lives, empowering them to have intentional conversations on important topics and deepening their faith in Jesus. That's why we call them Conversation Kits. Access is a donor-supported organization, so we need partners like you to continue to make videos like this possible. If you would like to join us, you can click the Give button in the top right corner of our website, access.org, to give a gift of support today. Thanks for being a part of our mission.